Okay. Are you testing now? I'm doing great. How are you, Drew? I'm talking about the great days of the band business.
Okay, we've got the monitor right on there.
Right on there. It's right in there. Right, it's built in. Is that it?
Yeah. You look really good.
Shall I put my Tony jacket on?
Or shall I sit in shirts? Okay. Where you're at.
Okay.
I got a list of questions.
Sure. I'm ready. So who have you taped Howie Mann and
the only person I taped is Howie.
Howie.
He's the only person I've interviewed.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. I'm ready. Check it out because I got a little more comfortable. See that I'm still
you're fine now?
I'm still in your lens.
Okay.
All right. First of all, let me say I'm really, really excited to meet you and your family. I remember Joe really, really well. He was always one of the guys in the band that I could always depend on. You know, you always had to have in a group of 15 or 16 guys. Few guys I always had to keep my eye on. Phil Urso was one I'd have to keep my eye on. But Joe was like always there. He was always there. And those are the kind of guys you really love to have in a band or in a police department or in anywhere else you work. It's really important to have a guy like that. Anyway, so glad you're here. Ask me some questions, see if I can remember the answers. But Joe, I knew would always be there if the job was to begin at 8 o'clock. I knew Joe was there at 8 o'clock. I knew some of the other guys, it's 8 o'clock and they're not on the stand or they're backstage or they don't have their jackets on or something. But Joe was there. And when it came time to play a solo, he was always there also. He never, you know, he never messed up. And I'm sure you remember even more than how long he stayed with the band. I can't remember. I'm not good at dates. Do you remember, Drew, about how long?
I think that he was there from November of 48. And I'm pretty sure your band broke up after a week at the Steel Pier.
Oh, I see.
Is that about right, about July of 51?
I don't remember. We broke up a couple of times, and then instead of going on the road permanently like I did before when Joe was with us, then after that I would do weekends and mostly work. You know, all the work in the band business was Friday, Saturday, Sunday anyway. So I lived in New York, and I was, I got married after that, or was going with Amy. And so Monday through Thursday, I'd be in New York, and then I'd just go out on weekends. So I didn't remember the dates, but that's about right.
Who my father hung out with in the band?
Well, you know, I don't really know the answer to that. You know, I knew the guys. In fact, I was trying to remember, and maybe you remember, I was trying to remember who were the trumpet players that sat next to Joe in that time. Do you remember?
Johnny D.
Johnny D. Well, Johnny D was one of the original players in my band from Philadelphia. Johnny looked something like your son, Joe. He had a face as round and a body as round as your little Joe.
Right.
And Johnny D. Who else was in it? Do you remember any other trumpet players' names that you looked up?
Jimmy Padgett.
Oh, Jimmy Padgett. Yep, I remember him too. Another one that I would say was like Joe. They were really, I could depend on. He was always there.
Why did you pick my father to have the jazz chair?
Well, because, you know, it's very tricky. Almost everybody goes without saying. Everybody thinks they're a great jazz player. Every trumpet player that was in the band, you know, Johnny D, even though he was a terrific lead player, he would love to play solos, but he just wasn't a jazz player. And Jimmy Pageant played some jazz, as I remember. But your father really was a jazz player. I mean, you know, he was a real soloist. And you know that right away. Same thing in the saxophone section. You have a lead alto player who really doesn't play jazz, and then the other guys do. It's you know, it's like someone has a expertise in one area or other. So it was sort of when we looked for who was going to be the jazz player, we looked around Philadelphia, and I think he was. I can't remember who recommended him either. Do you remember that either?
I don't know that, Elliot.
I wish I could remember that. I wish I could remember all these things. If I knew you were going to take me, I would have made a list. But
right.
Anyway, the more you tell me of who was in the band, the more my memory is. You know, it gets me going. Who else was in the band? Who were in the trombones then? Do you have that?
Yeah.
That's pretty good. When your father was in?
The trombones, we had Cy Berger.
Cy Berger, he was a friend of Howie Mann's. They were close. And they were New Jersey, the New Jersey group.
And also we had Vince Forrest.
Vince Forchetti. It was his real name. He called himself Vince Forrest. Now, he was the jazz player. He was a very good jazz player.
And Chuck Harris.
Chuck Harris. Oh, don't remember him as well as the others. They're not. Who was the rhythm? Was Howie Mann? Who was the bass player?
Oh, Tom O'Neill.
Tom O'Neill, right. And the saxes were? Beside Phil?
Well, you had Merle Breadwell.
Merle Breadwell, that's two.
Bruno Rondinelli.
Bruno Rondinelli. He was also from Philadelphia, up near where you live, up in the Northeast. Remember him? He was also very quiet. Very, very quiet. And he wrote. He was an arranger. Very talented, but very quiet. Didn't talk at all. Your father talked. Your father was. And who else do you have?
Phil Urso, of course.
Bruno Rondinelli. Who were the lead alto?
We had also.
Oh, Joe Saldo.
Joe Saldo and Louis Giamo.
Lou Giamo. Yeah, he was from Norristown. You remember him too, yeah.
A
lot of the talented fellows in Philadelphia came from South Philadelphia, where there was in those days, 50 years ago, was a terrific, very talented musical section of Philadelphia.
On the French horn, you had Tony Miranda.
Tony Miranda was fantastic. Tony Miranda went from us to the Cleveland Symphony with George Zell. That's how good he was.
Why did Jack Hunter leave?
Jack Hunter and Rosalind Patton were the singers from Philadelphia, and they went out with my band originally. But they were the original. Jack was even before Joe was with my band. What was your question? Why?
Yeah, I know he was replaced by Danny Ricardo.
Well, he decided to get off the road. He was married and had been traveling for a long while. Look, when you're married, it's very hard to do the road. And it's also, you don't make enough money. But, you know, you spend a lot of money on the road. And Danny Ricardo was a real road rat. And in other words, he would drive the truck, make extra money for me driving the truck. He was a good singer, and he was a real road rat. Jack was a more... was a homebody. He was a Philadelphia homebody, South Philadelphia homebody.
Where did you pick up Danny Ricardo?
I can't remember. Somebody, you know, when Jack decided he was going to leave, and his wife said, "Look, you've had enough. We can't have a family. You don't have. You're not making enough money." Is what happened all that time. Then I got Danny.
He seemed more of a single type guy.
Oh yeah, the road rats are the guys that love to be on the road. They're not the what we used to say, they're not the marrying guys. You know, they like to meet women in the various towns that we went to. Danny was one of those.
How and when did you form your band?
Well, the original band? The original band I formed in Philadelphia I had been at University of Pennsylvania, and I had the band on the football field for the, and we were we got a lot of press in the Inquirer and the Philadelphia Bulletin saying how great the war had just started. And so I had a band that had guys from the Army in it, had guys who were training at Penn and guys who were in the Navy, Naval Reserve, Army Reserve. So when we went on the field, instead of all being in University of Pennsylvania uniforms, the band was, half of them were in khakis of the Army, because that's what they had to wear, they were in the Army. The other half were in Navy uniforms, and then I had some guys who were either 4F or whatever, in Penn uniforms. But having those guys from the services, they were older, they were better players, so I made special arrangements for this band. And we came on the football field, and that's when Penn had a great team. And we had 80,000. Now they get, if they're lucky, to get 10 or 15 or 20,000. And so it made the front page of the Evening Bulletin that not only had the team changed, but the band had changed. And here was a great band where I made an arrangement of swing tunes for the band. And so when the head of WCAU read that afterwards, and he knew my father was working there, the head of CAU was there, and he said, "Hey, Elliot, when you graduate, will you come and have the band at WCAU?" So that's where I started. So I would say, that's before your father joined me, I had this band in Philly. And we got really well known because the war was on, and whenever they couldn't have a late night broadcast, we broadcast from Philadelphia, and we got well known, and we got a recording contract for Columbia, and that started it. Soon after that, I went on the road, and then soon after that, when the first group, first older guys that started with me decided they'd had enough, like Jack Hunter and other guys, that's when Joe joined the band. Is that a short enough answer?
What kind of band was it, Elliot?
Well, it was originally, it was two kinds of a band. It was a, on the ballad side, it was somewhat like Claude Thornhill's band. It was very moody. And yet, on the jazz side, it was sort of bebop. And we had, writing for us, of course, were Jerry Mulligan, who since after that went on to become a very famous writer. And originally, your father, Joe, replaced Red Rodney, who was the first trumpet player in my band when I first started. And he played with us for a little while, and then he was hired away by Gene Krupa. Both Red Rodney and Mulligan went from my band to Gene Krupa then. Your father came after that.
Do you remember, Frankie Lane seems to be somebody that you worked with a lot.
Well, we did the band played the Paramount Theater with Frankie Lane. And he was big then, so we were there for like 5 weeks. Which, you know, the best thing, we used to do hundreds of one-nighters. The trouble is, the guys hated them, I hated them. And the only time you get to sit down, sit in one place, was when we played the Pennsylvania Hotel, the Café Rouge, when we went to the Pennsylvania, we went to the Roosevelt, as you said. I don't know exactly where your father went with me, I'm sure you know more than I do. But that's what they look forward to. Oh boy, 4 weeks in New York, 5 weeks in New York, we can be in one place.
You never sat down in New York for 9 months or anything?
Never. No, we didn't. We weren't so lucky. We never had any of those things.
What was the reputation of my father among the business?
Among the musicians? He was always, was very, very good. I don't think he didn't get as much recognition as he deserved. And you know how the business is, some people get it and some don't, and you don't know why. And so I don't think enough people know who your father was. I guess you've found that out if you've been around.
What's the story about the recording Elevation?
What about it?
Well, I know there's a story behind it that Columbia didn't want it recorded.
Absolutely. Columbia didn't want us to record any bebop. They didn't think that was commercial. And I had, and for us to record Elevation, we had to record one or two tunes they wanted us to record that I didn't want to do. And the funny thing is, Elevation is, I would say, the number one song that I've ever recorded. It's gotten more play. As you know, it's in other collections. Columbia has released it many times, and so that was that's.
The deal was, I think the guys in the band, the boys in the band,
right?
They made a deal with you that, look, try to get Columbia to record this thing, and we'll go around, and we'll hand it out, and we'll
do it. I'm sure they all did that. I mean, I was very young at the time, and I was wanting to make it on Columbia, so they had an A&R man in those days, and he didn't want us to do anything that was that, you know, not commercial. So we really did it. And I don't remember that the boys did it, but I'm sure they did, because we were really proud of the record. And it still sounds good after all these years. You know, it's 50 years, right? 48 years?
Yeah.
How time flies.
50 years,
wow. That's great.
How come you jumped the Decca?
After Columbia no longer wanted us, then I did a record on another label. I can't remember that other label. Rhythm and blues label. That didn't happen. King did that.
I know you made two college prom albums.
Yeah, I did that for Decca. They weren't very good. And I mean, I just wanted to keep recording. So that was the thing. No, your father was with my band at the height of our popularity. And after that, I had a good band later on a couple of times, but it never was, you know, never hit like that original one.
Where was that church where you did recording for Columbia?
It was the Columbia. It was in 56th or 54th Street. It was a hall, very famous hall. It was a church originally, and then became a German hall. It had great sound, and that's I can't remember what it's called now.
I think it was the address I got was 270 East 30th Street.
Oh well, that's another place. That's where we recorded something else. 230 was that where it's called Liederkranz Hall. That was where I did the original recordings, and I thought Elevation was done there, so maybe it was.
Yeah, my dad said it was done at that old church.
Yeah, it wasn't originally a church, yeah. Great, great hall.
Remember Al Jazbo Collins?
Of course. Very, very, very well do I remember him.
I have a film clip of you and him together in Salt Lake City.
Really? I remember that. That was before he got famous. After that, after Salt Lake City, I think he went to New York or somewhere else. Yeah, I remember that very well. He was a good guy. How do you have all these things? Boy, you're really great. Father would be proud of you there, Drew.
Thanks.
Really.
Thank you.
Yeah. Because
you use oboe, the bassoon, and all these other instruments,
right,
the other band leaders did not use.
Right.
Why?
Well, first of all, looking for something that was a little different. And second of all, because I was brought up in classical music, where a lot of these other band leaders came out of the jazz field. So I thought it would give the band a different sound, and it did.
What was the sound, Elliot?
Well, that was basically it. It's sort of this classical overlay in the Moody records, and then the jazz things and the bebop in the bebop records.
Jerry Mulligan, what's the story with his relationship with you and the band?
Well, Jerry, he was originally, Jerry was from West Philly High, West Catholic in West Philly, and in those days at 16 you could leave school, and Jerry was very unhappy with his own family, and he left school, and he sort of lived with me. He lived with our family, with my mother, and he wrote for the band. He wrote all the original charts for the band. And then, and as I said before, until he left my band and went with Gene Krupa. And then years later, he came back and wrote for me over the years after that, also came back and played with the band later on. But he was a very, we were one of those love-hate relationships after that, as so many things happen. We were very, very close. He got on drugs, as you know, and he was in a really bad way. And then his second wife got him off drugs completely. And then what really was a big argument and fights we had was were that even though when he couldn't work anywhere else, I always hired him and had him write for me, and he signed contracts for all these pieces that I published those pieces. And so years later, he wanted everything back for free. I said, Jerry, that isn't the way it worked, that I published that music. That was our relation, that was our problem. But then at the end of his life, he became my friend again. And when he was dying, his wife said, I was one of the, just like you're talking about your father's early life, she said he talked about his early life that was the best part of his life. And so I talked to him, talked to her, talked at his funeral. And so, you know, it's very interesting, a relationship that went back over at least 30 or 40 years.
Can you talk about the drug problem and how it destroyed the road band?
Oh, it's terrible. I had a, not so much the band that your father was in, but the next band was the one I was talking about, where Ollie Wilson came to me one day. Ollie was like my friend and set the band up. Great trombone player. He came in and came one night and he said, "Hey, boss." He says, I feel really bad. I think 14 out of the 16 guys are on heroin. We were out of town, and then it was just a terrible, awful experience. And someday I'll write the stories down that happened to me with that way. Wow. Really bad.
I know the Swope Brothers were big on it.
Oh, Swope Brothers, almost the whole band was on.
Do you?
They were great players, by the way.
Did it affect their playing? I guess it did.
Well, I've always, people ask me that, how did drugs affect people's playing? I never forget Jerry Mulligan, who was on drugs once, and then when he got off drugs and he was in my band, he would drink. And he said to, he would drink brandy. He said to my wife one day, that's years later, he said, I don't know how Elliot ever did it, how he could face this audience every night without having either alcohol or drugs. He said, you know, it's such a tough life. It was so hard. But the trouble with drugs, Drew, is that the young musicians thought that Charlie Parker and they were so great, and that they thought the drugs made them great. Of course, it wasn't. It was what they had. But since they were on drugs, they thought maybe if I take drugs and do it, it'll do it. And that ruined Phil Erso for a long, long time too. Terrible. So, and I think I don't know what, when the time your father was on the band, whether Phil was as hooked as he was later. I don't think so.
Yet.
I don't think so. It came much later.
What do you recall about Rudy Van Gelder?
Well, I didn't know Rudy as much as the other guys did, probably your father and all the other guys. Jazz owes a lot to Rudy, because a lot of the bands and players would go out there to record, and he would record them out in his home in Jersey. And I didn't do enough of my work there, but I'm sure Joe did and some of the other guys from Philly. So I know he was a very important person for the jazz field, our field.
Do you remember the Meadowbrook?
Of course. Frank Daly's Meadowbrook, sure.
Howie Mann has a lot of recordings.
Yeah, from Howie was, yeah. Howie was great. Howie was like what you're doing. He would always, he's the only one that had a camera all the time and took pictures and try to keep us all in line about, you know.
So, like, you remember my father? Did you ever, like, tell him how to play the solo?
Oh, no. No. You never tell a really good jazz player how to play. You might say, in this number, I'd like a really hot solo. This number, I'd like a cool jazz solo. But no more than that. You don't tell them how to play. You don't tell a painter how to paint. But if it was a ballad and he was playing a lot of high notes, which he had good taste, he didn't have to tell him that. But in general, you don't tell the players.
He didn't try to be a Dizzy Gillespie or a Maynard Ferguson.
He wasn't a Maynard Ferguson type. So I remember let me see now, can I put the right words in it? He was more, what I would say is tasty. If I could think of a one word description of his jazz playing, I would say he was a really tasty player, Drew. And that fit in exactly the image of the band that I've had. And he looked that way and he played that way, and I was really proud to have him in my band. Anyway, I really think it's great that you came over and we did this.
Thanks.
I really appreciate it. Good.
Thanks.
Thank you.